picture today.
We can get that, no problem.
They took that. We're on an air mattress, and I just told them just take it. So leave it.
Transmission. I know.
That's the heck of a way to have laugh with.
Yeah.
I've got a lot of problems.
I don't
know. I'd be surprised. They said you
were going to
be here too, Lisa told me.
Congratulations. I got congratulations on the time. I can't stay from dinner.
I just had to see it. I'm glad you were surprised.
Thank you. I'll do what I know you're not Catholic, but I think this is a lot of Catholics, and we ought to take up a collection. But I will do one thing for you. I'll take all the calories out of the food.
Yeah.
Heavenly Father, we thank you for the life of Dick and all the good work he has done. We ask you to give him many happy years in his retirement and to bless him and watch over him. We ask you to bless this food which you have given us through your goodness. And finally, we ask you to give everyone a safe journey home after we've eaten and drinking. And don't forget, by the way, if you have one for the road, you have a trooper for a chaser.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Enjoy the evening. Make sure you get to say congratulations to Dick. Thank you all for coming. serving dessert, we thought we'd have a couple special awards for our special guest tonight. To start it off, I'd like to introduce, where was he? I just saw him. Roy? Somebody stick their head out the door and ask our sheriff to come in. Roy, you ready?
I'm ready.
All right. For a special recognition for a special man, Lake County Sheriff Roy Dominguez.
Thank you very much. Good evening, everybody. Great food, wasn't it?
Yeah.
Thank you very much, Dick Tate, for retiring, huh? Well, Dick, as we all know, you're a great fella. Always. You know, I can remember back in 1982 when I was a young deputy prosecutor getting started. And, you know, Dick was just, I mean, he was just a towering fella in terms of his reputation and his presence. And I can remember him walking into the courtroom, and I was a young deputy prosecutor with black hair back then. I said, God, there's Dick James. And you know what? I'm sure Dick, for all of us, that feeling hasn't changed. Love to see you. And there's Dick James, isn't it? Just an awing fellow. You know, Dick, one of the moments I can recall, we had one hearing, and the judge would tell Dick James, hey, I want you to make the very best and use you assist as you possibly can. And Dick says, well, of course. And I'm sitting there thinking, what could I do against Dick James? And so later on, come up this way. I'm trying to get there. So I'm thinking, what could I possibly do against Dick James, right? And so the next time we showed up, and Dick being the gentleman that he is always, and we go up to court, and we go before the judge, and the judge says, well, Mr. James, you're here, the prosecutor's here, your client's not here. What do you have to say? Well, you know, Judge, last time we were here, you said for me to give my client the best advice possible. Seeing Mr. Dominguez here, I told my client, better not show up, don't stand a chance. So he didn't show up. But he's always a gentleman, just a great guy. And you know, Dick, I didn't realize after looking at the board there, I mean, I know you've always had a distinguished career. I just didn't realize that you also were a police officer with the Dyer. Also, I used with the Dyer Police Department. I didn't realize you were a police officer there. Many years ago in 1976, before I became a lawyer, I used to be a state trooper, and I was assigned here to the old Sherrillville post, many who remember that. And we, the state police and Sherrillville and Dyer, all were very close to it together. You must have already left, and he was a lawyer by then.
Yeah.
Anyways, I followed Dick James as well, and I'm going to go to law school as well and be a lawyer. But today is a great moment, your night, and we're all here to honor you. And you're just a great fellow. I just wanted to say that. You're just a wonderful individual, great lawyer, great ethics, just a wonderful role model for us all. And it's great to, you know, in life, it's all very, very short. I'm very thankful for the good Lord for giving me the opportunity to meet you and to know you as a friend. And tonight, as the Lake County Sheriff, I have a distinct pleasure and honor. If you would please come on up here.
Yeah.
And you know, Dick, I think they want to see you, so I want you to stand right over here. I want you to stand over here on this side right here. There you go. Now turn around and face me over here. There you go. I want you to say, and to repeat, raise your right hand. We're not going to put you under oath.
Don't do that.
What's that, Donna?
Don't do that.
Not the other arm?
Don't put him under oath.
I just want you to say that I, state your name.
I, Richard L. James.
Do solemnly swear. That I will support the Constitution of the United States of America. And the Constitution of the State of Indiana. And promise to the best of my ability to be the very best Lake County honorary deputy sheriff to the best of my ability. So help me God. Congratulations. The Lake County Deputy, it's a Lake County Honorary Deputy Sheriff, which is the highest award that any sheriff can bestow upon its citizen. With that, thank you. There you go. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. Dick, with that, in the event that tonight, that if they start roasting you and you need some arrest powers, you now have it.
My badge is still over there.
Thanks, Roy. That was very nice. One of the things that really impressed me is when the invitations went out and people said, yeah, I'm glad I'm coming or glad you invited me, there's so many people that begged to make a special note and mention about Dick tonight. So there's a couple of people that we selected that have a couple of special words to say about Dick. So we're going to start off with a family member, Tommy James. Tom? And they only got a couple minutes each, so it's not going to be a sermon. It's going to be a prayer.
When I heard I had 2 minutes, I begged for at least five. He is my uncle, and I feel I deserve at least that much latitude in expressing what I feel about this man. I could go on forever. I've tried to capsulize what I'd like to say. Two short stories that have to be told, and I'll be brief with them. Then I'm going to go into a little bit of personal feelings. Number one story. An attorney who's present here had told me a story one time about how much he respected my uncle. And he said, you know, one time I was in court at court call, 8:30 in one of the courts, and lo and behold, I'm in there. I'm not dressed real well, and Dick James comes in to represent somebody. He felt bad because he did not have on his best coat, his best shoes. And here he's with one of the top guns in the state of Indiana. In court, well, I know he was coming, I'd dress a little bit better. As he's sitting thinking about this, he's looking at his shoes. And, well, I wish I had put at least a coat of polish on my shoes. And then he said, Dick James, Dick, and I don't know him, but I know my uncle Red. But Mr. James gets up for his turn at the podium and he looks at Red's shoes, and he said, you know what? Red's shoes looked worse than his did. Made him feel better. Another quick story, which was related to me by my mother, who was here many years ago when, and I believe this is before her and my father had all the children they have. They were at my grandma's house, and they're upstairs in Dyer at 2442 Hart Street. My mom's upstairs, and she knows Red is cooking breakfast downstairs. She's upstairs, and she hears a loud bang, whack, like the whole stove had fallen over. So she runs downstairs, and she says she sees Red at the stove. And what happened? He goes, I busted the egg yolk. I had notes that I was going to have in my pocket. And I think if there's one man that I don't need notes to talk about, it's my Uncle Red. He's been everything that an uncle can typify to me. There's not many guys, and I'm retired 24 years from law enforcement in a local department here. There's not a lot of guys that can pick up a telephone and probably get the best counsel that any man can have in Indiana. And the only thing it's going to cost me is a flat of geraniums in the spring. He ranks up as high as my father with men I respect, and I've been so proud over the years to see his picture in the paper, and I see, and I've got my own Uncle Red's scrapbook, the likes of which I see some over there, and I see him with Doc Nicosia, and I remember telling my dad he looks like a mafia hitman. And I'm damn proud to say he's my uncle. And he's always been there for me. I know that he's always had an open ear for me whenever I've needed something. And it would not be right for me to not mention Aunt Marge here. Because I know she's here somewhere. And I'm sure she's disappointed she can't be here like we all are, but I know she's here somewhere. When I look back on Cherry Slices and cleaning their house on Carnation Street and everything this man has been to me, I really don't know what to say other than end it by saying, you know, I'm damn glad to have called him my uncle. And God bless you.
Thanks for those words, Tom. And now we're going to hear from another Tom, special friend Tom Blaskovich. There he is, Tom.
Thank you, Ken. I don't know what I can say about my oldest friend in life. We started first grade together. Dick came about the middle of the year, am I correct? And we've been friends like for 63 and a half years, which is an awful long time. I can't roast him. I think he's one of the most loyal, dedicated people I've ever met in my life. He's been a great friend. We had a lot of fun going through school together. A lot of mischievous things. Several of our former classmates are here, and I showed them something that Dick started in 1952. We had a principal come to town that none of us liked when I got rid of old Charlie Hunt, and Dick decided that we got to get a new principal, so he decided on Marty Keneally, who was a year ahead of us in school. And Marty's platform that Dick wrote up for him was 3 days of school a week, 3 periods a day, and higher pay for teachers and janitors. And Dick finished that little bit because he figured then the teachers would back us up. And he wrote on here, this document was drawn up by the sophomore and junior class stooges. And then he signs it, Red James, as large as John Hancock signed the Declaration of Independence. This is a copy, Dick, but this is for you. One of the things I'm glad that didn't happen is our class prophecy said that Dick and a girl that was with us in school, Lois Hogan, were going to be beauty shop partners specializing in dyeing red hair blonde. Hence, Red James. He also has another name that I put upon him when we were in grade school. And how it came about, I looked for all the stuff I have at home and couldn't find it, but Cornelius Watermelon Moose. And that's a name that has stuck with him consistently through them. We went through high school, grade school, high school, and college together, and then one day we got on a bus in Crown Point to go take our Army physicals. Very long day, as I recall. We had to be down there about 5:30 or 6 o'clock in the morning. Spent the entire day at the center up in Chicago, and we got on a bus, and somebody said something about, boy, we sure could go for a beer. Dick walked up to the bus driver and convinced him to stop at this I guess it was a liquor store, wasn't it? South Stony Island Avenue. And he became the hero of all of the recruits on that bus. It was jammed, I'll tell you. Another funny little story is Dick was helping Cecilia and I move into our first apartment in 1957. 2 weeks. It was, in fact, the date was June 18th, 4 days before our wedding. And I picked Dick up in Dyer. I was living with my folks in Schererville. And we went and carried a refrigerator up 3 flights of stairs. And Dick says, what about, we're all done now. I says, I got to get home to Dyer. I says, you'll get home to Dyer. So I took him to my employer, Calumet Chevrolet, and sold him a 51 Dodge Meadowbrook for $200. I wouldn't give him a ride home, but I took him for a ride. Here's the original copy of the order. I say that. I don't know of a better friend, a sharper attorney, other than the guy that was in the cartoon, The Wizard of Id, today in the Hammond Times, that was before the judge, and he says, I want to plead a lesser cause for my client. And he says, well, he's been arrested for littering. He says, what could be less than that? He says, was it second-class littering or something? With that, I'm done. I don't want to take up any more time, but a great, great guy, and I know you all know that.
was his partner for 30 years. I didn't know about that nickname. I'll have to remember it. Now a couple words from a special friend, Jim Thomas.
I tell you, you know, what can you say about Red Yanks? I mean, you know, some people know him as Dick, but I mean, Richard Francis James. That's almost like FDR. You know, it really is. We've been friends for 60 some years. I can't say one bad word about him. Now, you know I'm lying. You know, but I tell you what, truthfully, I've known the whole family, and believe it or not, as much as he has succeeded as an attorney at law, he was the dumbest one of the family. You know, and that comes from Tom. You know, but really, his mother and father were just a joy to know. Of course, I have a little bit of, I guess, prejudice, being that we're both of Welsh blood. You know, of course, Red never talked in Gaelic, but he's just been a wonderful, wonderful person. But when I look around here tonight, and I see all the distinguished people, and even you attorneys. But the people that I recognize the most, and especially Tom Blazkowicz getting up here. I mean, Tom was the manager of all our sports teams. And the one thing that Red did in his life, he really excelled in everything he did. He never wanted to lose. And that's the way it was in sports. But he was a standout in basketball, football, and baseball. And I think we have half of his baseball team here today. I mean, we've got Jim Vinges, who was a pitcher. We've got Frankie Britton. And Frankie's got a special place in my heart because Red was a catcher. And they had a pickoff play. Frankie was a center fielder, and the second baseman had moved over, and Red could throw. Frankie would sneak in from second or from center field to second base. The guy's taking a lead off, and you see the second baseman was playing way off. Red could throw that guy out from his haunches, and they did it many and many a time. And then Bill Penman's here, and Bill was the third baseman. He used to laugh at the asshole trying to steal third. You know, it never made it. But I mean, these were some of the things that we really enjoyed as kids. I mean, when we grew up in Dyer, I think it was, I know I personally, I was out there 2 years before anybody had even let me play with their dogs. You know, it was a German Catholic town, and if you weren't Catholic, they were sort of, they were tolerant of you, they said hello. But I mean, they would speak to you when you went up to the post office because we all had post office boxes. We didn't get home delivery. And his father's name was Thomas James. My father's name was James Thomas. So when we got home delivery, we used to have to take each other's mail back and forth because they got confused. You know, so it's just a wonderful, wonderful thing to know a person like Red James and the many things that he's done, not only for his family and community and just everything. He's a man that never takes a bow for anything. He's always excelled in his life, always well. And I'm just like the rest of you, I'm just so tickled to be here to see this. I never thought it. I thought Red would be just like me. We just work till we die and fade away, you know, just like an old soldier. But I don't really think this is the end of it. I mean, there's going to be another John Nicosi or somebody that's going to come up, and Red's going to say, oh, I'll take that case, I'll come out of retirement. You know, I know that's going to happen. You know, you just don't die. You know, Don may even get them driving motorcycles. Who the hell knows? You know. But it's just a pleasure being here, and I'm just tickled to death that everybody, and I seen Bernie Carter was here earlier. I don't know if Bernie's still here or not, but I mean, when Roy comes up and deputizes the guy, you know, he wasn't really a police officer in Dyer. He was a town marshal. And the only people he ever arrested was his brother and me. You know? So, and with that, I'll let you have it.
As many of you know, I've been partners with Dick for many, many years, and throughout those years, I'd often hear about club. Well, tonight I guess we get to hear from Dewey. There he is, Dewey from club. And I think we need a special chair up here, right, Dick?
Oh, we got that.
Oh, we got it? Okay.
Will that fit in the scale?
Nothing.
I had to sit up in front here like that when I retired and he ripped me up. Good evening, everybody. When I walked up to the door and met him, he said, I can't believe all these people came. Well, Richard said I should say that. I got my 50 bucks. Did everybody get their 50 bucks? It's an honor to be here to honor, or is it the roast, Dick James? I can't believe all you people are so nice. That's a different Dick James than our club knows. I know some of you call him Big Red, some of you call him Boss, and some four-letter words. Our group club just calls him Dick James, so when I refer to Dick, you know, that's who it is. Many of you know him professionally, but I want to tell you some of the things about his social graces and how our group's lives became entwined. Truthfully, don't you find it an inconvenience to be here? I've been told that the best audience is one that is intelligent, well-educated, and a little overserved. We got a winner tonight. My wife gave me a kiss before I came up here, and that says to keep it short, stupid. Tom got 2 minutes, and he went six. Last night, Lisa called Pat and said, I got five. So, 5 times 3 is 15. I do feel like Napoleon did. I'm pretty nervous up here. And Napoleon was going to a big battle. He wore a blue coat, gold braids, white pants. And he's waiting for his captain to come out. And the captain finally came out all dressed in red. And Napoleon says, you know, you're pretty gaudy, aren't you? They can pick you right out in battle. He says, well, if I get wounded, I don't want my men seeing me bleed. I want them to keep on fighting. Then Napoleon excused himself and went in and changed his white pants to brown underwear and brown pants. I sort of feel like that. The years are adding up for me. You know, I'm even older than Dick is, if anybody can believe that. And I need big notes. You probably can read them from way in the back. That's how big my notes have to be. I'm up here representing club that Ken talked about, and I'll just for a few minutes. It's not a 2 or 3 word organization. It's just club. We have 12 members who've been close for over 40, some of them for over 50 years. And it's a treasure that few people have. We're not relatives, we're not friends, but we're a special, wonderful family. Hey, wake up. Sure.
I'm trying.
Hey, did you hear that? Not, that's a miracle. Since biblical times, you've never heard a jackass speak. We share openly, we laugh often, we trust always, and we care deeply. I like to introduce the club because there's sort of a small group that's here this evening. I'd like to have them just stand for a second. Sheila and Patrick McCambridge. Donna and Paul Sawitsky. And Nick was the last... Nick was the last to be accepted. It was a 5-5 vote. And Marge had to break the tie. Like everything else, she had to bail him out of things. And I say the best of the group for last, my wife, Pat. The others have moved out of state and couldn't be here. I'd just like to quickly give you a couple of samples of club dinners at restaurants. At Gino's Steakhouse in Harvey, which was a really nice club back then, the club was given a separate room because Dick became overserved and boisterous. At Lorenzetti's restaurant in Hazelcrest, after Innocently, we sat there drawing names like we did every year for Christmas exchange. And a couple was sitting nearby us, and they heard the part of the conversation, and so they came over and wanted to get in on the exchange of names. So you know what that meant. But that gave us a lot of laughs for years. But the lady of the two, she was real hesitant about taking a chance on getting Dick's name. The next thing, but maybe I sneak out the last door, the back door. At retirement dinners, you're supposed to tell a lot of lies. And I thought of telling some of the thousands of lawyer stories, but I can't. They're all true. Earlier, I mentioned about Dick being overserved. On another occasion, the club had a dinner at the McCambridge household. And early in the morning, he dashed out the back door and left his food and his drinks on the shrubbery out there. Never grew back, and Patrick had to finally put a patio over that area. One of the club's Christmas gifts exchanges, Dick received Marge's gift of a nightie by mistake. Since then, some people have told me that it might not have been a mistake. That he actually requested it. And they even have pictures. On another night, the club was going out to eat at the spa over by Chesterton, and Dick and Marge couldn't make it. He said he had a fire in his library and it burned his book. What really bothered him was that he hadn't even colored it. One day, Dick's daughter, Lisa, was at Meyer Shopping Center north up the road here. And as she was leaving, Sheila McCambridge and Ellen were there waiting for a ride home. And it had been quite a while, so Lisa agreed to take them home. And on the way home, Ellen asked Lisa, "What's in that bag on the floor?" And Lisa said, "Well, I got a bottle of wine for my dad." And Sheila says, "Good trade." I've been told that in a courtroom, Dick has a photographic memory. But sometimes he doesn't have any film. Through the years, on occasion, the club was sitting around talking, Dick wouldn't respond, he would say he got lost in thought. Boy, is that a familiar territory. Just one example of how he thinks. You know, he always had a lot of dogs. And we came over one time, he had two new dogs, and we asked him what their names were. And he said, Rolex and Timex. And I said, "Well, that's a little strange." He says, "Well, they're watchdogs." And someday, I have to tell you the story about Boyd Bennett. You know, see, nobody ever heard of Boyd Bennett. Nobody reacted. Some singer back 70-some years ago when he was a kid. One day, six of us club members went into Sherville restaurant. I think it was Baker Square down the road the other way towards Peebles. And in a nearby booth, Lisa and Richard were sitting with Dr. March. So we didn't even say hello because they were in conversation. But we heard one of them say, "Doc, I think my dad's mind is wandering. Doc March replied, don't worry, that mind can't go far. There was a time that he worked for the feds. And he was invited to speak at a Native American reservation about American justice. And he went on and on, and every few sentences they would get up and yell, Koya, Koya, Koya. And boy, it made him feel happy that he was getting a great response. And after the speech, they got on the bus and they went back to the reservation and to see the prize bulls. And as he was getting off the bus, they said, don't step in the Koya. I have a can here that this evening, and I bet all of you wish I had given him years ago. BS repellent. You know, around the office, they quite often call him boss, knowing that backwards it means double SOB. He and I don't really have much that we agree on. I'm a Cubs fan, he's a Cardinal fan. He's so hooked on Anheuser-Busch Cardinals that he even taught his kids the grammar rule, I before E, except after C, or when used in the word Budweiser. I'm an Illinois basketball fan, and he's an Indiana University fan. And at least I think he still is, you know, with Bobby Knight and leaving and all that. But we finally agreed on one thing. On the 4th of July, we were having a beanbag tournament at our house. And we were up getting ready to throw the beanbags, and I asked him, do you want the solid color bags or you want the stripes? And he says, give me the stripes. It reminds me of many of my clients. That's where we agreed. I often told him that I felt the taxpayers could save a lot of money if he retired. They wouldn't have to build so many jails. Hey, I'll wait. Now I do want to get a little serious. In each of our lives, there are only a few people that we love, respect, and who have made us better persons. Dick is definitely one of those. Dick, I hope in some small way, club members have given something to you. We know that you have contributed much to us. We couldn't have a greater friend. Dick enjoys writing and reading poetry, and I found a couple I feel are appropriate. Dick, in your life, if your life was an open book, the pages would be tinged with gold. And we would read a story there to be remembered and retold. For we would read of how you gave to each and every one you met, the fullness that your heart could give, the love that no one could forget. And you would take a special place within our minds and with our hearts too, the place we'd often come to dream, and there with love remember you. One more brief poem from Club. We shared a lot together. We walked a common road. In many ways, these moments formed a special episode. We can't foresee the future or know how our lives will blend, but more and more Club knows that we have found a lasting friend. It's something rare to find a friend whose laugh inspires a smile, who shares life's joys and disappointments, traced a common mile. But we can say with certainty that something from inside keeps telling us we're glad you've been a companion for the ride. Go forward, good friend, with the memories of this evening to lighten your heart and your way. God bless you, Dick James, and God bless America.
I won't need the chair. Some of the special friends that Dick's had. One of the first clients I met when I started working with James and James, and it turns out one of the best friends he's had is the next speaker, Jerry Hsu.
Tell him not to smoke all the time, but he never listens to me. I never listened to him either when he was my... But I go back to the late 50s with Red. I couldn't stand him. I despised the man. Truthfully, honest to God, I wanted to kill him. I hated the guy. He didn't like me. I come out of Gary, I thought he'd come out of the someplace in East Chicago, I didn't know where. He played for Sam and Henry Indians. A ruthless group of people that nobody liked. And he's a big guy, you know? He's a big guy. We played him all the time. We fought all the time. We didn't like him. He didn't like us. Neither one of us ever wanted to lose, and we left it all on the field every game. And Jim and Frank, you know, too. But I didn't know his name. For 5 years, I didn't know who the hell he was. All I know, he's that big guy behind home plate, the one to kill you when you come in home plate. And I tell you what, he was merciless when you came into home plate. He didn't care if the ball was in his hand or not. He was going to get you. Well, after about 5 years, after we're done playing baseball, I'm playing basketball with a group in Cherryville. We're playing some guys from Dyer, and here comes this big goon in. And I'm telling the guys, watch him. Watch him. He's dirty. Well, Red, after a while, I find out he's telling his guys, watch that ball-headed guy. He's no good, man. He's going to rack me. Well, believe it or not, we had a great game. We won. He doesn't remember that, but I do. We went down to Earl's Tap, and we had a couple beers. We became good friends. So when I won for Township Trustee in 1975, I got even. I asked him to be my attorney. For the next 20 years, he served St. John Township for $500 a year. And him and Marge at Christmas time would take three, four, five families, probably spend $2,000 a year on Christmas gifts for the needy. I always did things my way, and then I'd come and tell Red what I did, and then he'd have to take care of it. And he always couldn't believe that I would do something without asking him first. I never asked him, because I knew how good he was. But, and then when I went for county commissioner, he came out to the county with me. And we had some cases where we sued the state and we on the reassessment in 1990. And Red goes in, to tell you what a good attorney is, usually lawyers have stacks of paper when they go into court and they bore the hell out of the judge. Red goes in with a very thin list, and he is so straight, so quick, so accurate, that I really think the judge appreciates him, and they want to see him in there more times. Because he's right to the point, he's always right, and he's the best lawyer I've ever seen. He's done more favor for people in Lake County, in Dyer. He's helped so many people, wouldn't take a penny. And this is a guy I hated. You know, but once I got to know him, and him and Marge, he was really a nice guy. Really a nice guy. And Bill, I like Bill. I like his brother Bill because we played mushball against each other. And Tommy and I didn't, we really didn't get involved in sports, but I didn't like him. And then when they found out he was in Dyer, my God, I couldn't believe it. And he plays for a team in East Chicago. You know, Jim, I don't know how you guys allowed that. But I'm telling you, this man is so good and so precious to all of us. When he told me he was retiring, I was sick. Because he does such a great job for Lake County. He's one of the best I've ever seen. And I'm fortunate, very fortunate, I played basketball against him one night. Because I found out what a guy he was. And I haven't had a better friend or a better person to call on when I needed him. He's always been there. And this is a great tribute to a great guy, a good athlete. You know. Boy, I tell you, this is great to get this done. But Red, they were second best. We were the best. And I don't see anybody from Sam and Henry's here. Well, look at how big he is. But Red, thank you for everything. Everybody in St. John Township, thank you for everything. God bless you.
You know, Jerry was telling me the truth when he said he didn't listen to Red. I remember the first time Dick told me about Jerry's shoe. He said, Yeah, Jerry came in and asked me about, could he do this at St. John Township? I said, no. He said, oh, well, hell, I'm already doing it. I just wanted to know what you had to say about it. And that was the relationship they had for many years, and it was a good one. One of the best compliments a lawyer can have is the accolades from his co-workers and contemporaries. So the next speaker would be Stan Jablonski, one of our co-workers.
Hi, everybody. To let you know exactly where I fit into the scheme of things, I was the young lawyer with the crappy shoes. years later, I take a look at my shoes. They're still crappy. You know, you look at the law firm, you look at Manning, he looks like he could be chairman of the Republican Central Committee. You look at Don Kapp, he looked like he fell off a motorcycle. It's very clear who the anchor of that firm was. Very, very clear. A story I like to tell is when Dick was representing a lot of the more elite and famous gangsters, they would pay him in bundles of $10,000 in a bundle. Each bundle had a rubber band. I used to count the rubber bands in Cap's ponytail. And I could see how well Dick was doing. It's been for 32 years, actually before that I knew of him. I've known him now for a long time. I think one of the nicest things that I can say about him is how nice he was to young lawyers, how he never took advantage of a young lawyer, how he would often try to help young lawyers. I'm really going to miss him, and wish you the best, and God bless you, Dick.
Thanks, Stan. As usual, your words are not only sincere, but they're entertaining, too. Another contemporary co-worker, I guess we call it the other side, the U.S. Attorney's Office. And one thing that always struck me about Dick's career, I didn't necessarily have that much to do with him on a regular basis, but the times that I did, he was always referred to as Mr. James, and to me, I always took that as a mark of total respect to my partner, Dick James, and his ability as a criminal defense lawyer. So we're going to give Mr. Van Bachman a chance to say some words tonight. Joe?
Thank you very much, Ken. Following Jablonski is always pretty hard on a number of reasons, but we'll let it go at that. There's one tradition with the Department of Justice. I haven't been there here that long, and the way the election's going, I probably won't be there much longer either. But we always try to get a plaque for somebody in an event like this. And when I first learned about this, I talked to Dave Kapp, and we went through the books the Department of Justice had, and we found this one thing for you, Dick, which, I mean, it was really fancy. Big, large, had your name and real bold type and everything else. So I ordered it, and they got in the office, and they said, Joe's only one problem. And I said, what's that? I said, well, they cut the budget. And I said, yeah. They said, well, we got to take it out of your salary. Dick, I'm sorry I don't have anything for you tonight. It's too bad or eating. When I first got up here in the early 70s, I came from southern Indiana, and I didn't know what the region even was. It was just kind of a term I heard down in Bloomington when I was at school, and it was never a good term. Matter of fact, I thought when I became an assistant U.S. attorney, I was going to be in Fort Wayne, and I actually showed up there, only to be told that, no, you're over on the other side of the state, and my new bride was almost died hearing that. But when I got over here in the early 70s, an assistant U.S. attorney, very young, and Dick was pretty young at that time, too. He had been an assistant about 5 years before that when I got over here. I cannot imagine from that time on to today any one person who I've really been more involved with cases, both in the prosecution side when I was an assistant U.S. attorney for a few years, and as a criminal defense attorney for many, many years, and now back as a prosecutor. But Dick actually, for me, became not just an attorney in the office that I had cases with, but he became a mentor for me. Dick knows there are times that I would have this bad moments going, and I'd call Dick up about it. And Dick's comment was, when your name's in the paper, the only thing that's important is not what they say, but how they get it, they spell it right. And I've taken that advice very seriously. But truly, I can't imagine anybody who's been more of a friend to me in the practice of law than Dick James. And the only thing I regret is, you know, there's always things you regret in your life, and you look back in your life about. The only thing I really regret is I was never a partner of Dick James's. And that's the one I'll probably feel the most about, because I would love to have that moment at some point in which I could have been your partner. Thank you very much, Dick.
Thanks a lot, Joe. We appreciate those words. And you mentioned the partner, so the next speaker is going to be Don Kapp, one of the partners.
I'm like Joe, I can't stand behind the podium because no one can see me. Although Joe did, he didn't know it, but the videotape is going to be right here. So the words were nice. When I started to work for Dick 19 years ago, we went to federal court one day, and I think Jim Richmond was a U.S. attorney, and Dick got in this big argument, and with the U.S. attorney, and my brother Dave was there, and we left, and all the way back to Dyer, he was just in this rage, and somebody dared to cut him off. I've been with him like 3 days, and some guy cut him off, and he puts down the window of his whatever big boat car he had at that time, because that's his favorite choice of automobiles. And he sticks his head out the window and goes, "Hey, motherfucker, going!" And he stomps on the gas, and we go down Holman Avenue at about 100 miles an hour. And I'm in the passenger seat going like, and he's not even watching. He's got one hand on the steering wheel and his head out. "You bother, you stop at that stop sign, I'll kick your ass." Thank God we got a red light, didn't it? Right when the guy had a green and he made it through, and he turned and he didn't go through, and we're stopping at the stoplight, and he goes, "I hate people like that." And I'm in the passenger seat and my heart's like, and we get back to my office, and Ken's there, and Dick's like, I'm like, "Ken, you're not going to believe what happened." I said, "Dick, tell him what happened." He's like, "Oh yeah, some guy cut me off." And if that's not Dick to a T, he can get so riled up about something, and usually in a trial, and within 2 seconds he can lose it. And that's his... I have learned so much from him, ever. The last trial him and I did, Melanie's trial, who's here. You know, I was sitting at the table when the defense lawyer had a light hair expert on the stand. And this guy was a paraplegic in a wheelchair. And Dick destroyed him with the utmost tact. And I sat there thinking to myself, this guy is incredible. He could have, those six people on the jury could have hated him, because the whole reason the defense lawyer put him up there was because he was in a wheelchair, because he certainly didn't know what he was talking about. But he was in a wheelchair, and they knew that if Dick attacked him, it would play in their favor. And Dick just destroyed this guy with the tact that, I mean, I would have went at him biting at his neck, you know? And the jury would have been pissed at me, but Dick handled him incredibly. And that's just something else I learned in the, how many trials have we done together? 2 minutes. He is an amazing individual, an amazing trial lawyer. I'm leaving the practice. And 2 months ago, somebody told me that I was a good trial lawyer. And I told them one thing. I said, I'm a good trial lawyer because everything I learned was from Dick Cheney.
Now you're going to hear from the other partner. I believe God has been good to me. He's blessed me. 30 years ago, when I was looking for a job, I didn't know where I was going to go, what I was going to do. Just kind of stumbling around. I was fortunate God directed me to Dick and Bill James, and I've been working there and his partner for 30 plus years. And the only thing I can say to you is that the best honor I'm going to have as a practicing lawyer is the law firm with James, James, and Manning. Everywhere I go, whether it's some small court in Elk County, federal court, I'm proud to say Dick James is my partner, and that's the best accolade I'm going to have for my career. Please stay and enjoy the evening. We've got it all night. We want you to enjoy the evening, have something to drink,
and desserts.
Help yourself to desserts at the dessert table, and make sure you say thanks to Dick before you leave. Thanks for coming tonight.
Won't be easy.
Remember, you're not in court.
Well, this was such a surprise tonight that I didn't even have a chance to prepare any contemporaneous remarks. One thing to tell you about the surprise that it was to me tonight, one thing I stopped saying many years ago, and I often told other lawyers this, I quit saying I've seen it all because then I saw something new. Now I've seen it all. This is amazing. The people that are here that span my lifetime from first grade through the baseball days, through the police days, through the federal prosecuting days, through the defense days, and into my retirement. Some months ago, when my children were among the first of my partners to know that I was going to retire at the end of the year, still in the process of slow retirement, but professionally, you could put a fork in me, so there'll be no comebacks. But they asked me if I wanted to have a party, and I said no. I came into the law practice in 1961 quietly, and I want to leave in 2004 quietly. You people have seen to it that that didn't happen, and I will be forever grateful. It's been truly a wonderful life and a wonderful evening. There are three people I would specifically want to mention that I wish could be here tonight. One was my secretary, Rachel Monterubio, my secretary, my confidant for 25 years, a great, great legal secretary. She passed away a few years ago. The other would be my big brother and mentor in the practice who taught me to try to do it right, to try to treat people like you want to be treated yourself. That's my brother Bill, who passed away unfortunately in 1983. And the last was my beloved wife, Marjorie. We married, I was a young assistant United States attorney. She was with me for almost 200 jury trials. The ups and the downs, and the many lawyers and the many judges that are here tonight can appreciate that I've often thought that whoever wrote the ecstasy of victory and the agony of defeat must have been a trial lawyer, because there are ups and downs that are unbelievable. There are emotional curves and roads and dips that I am tired of, I don't want to live them again, but they were there, and my wife was there every step of the way. She unfortunately passed away May 31, 2002, but she left behind a great legacy and many of the friends. Many of the friends that are here tonight were as much or more friends of Marge's than they are mine. I want to thank all the people who said things tonight. Some of it not very accurate. My friend Dewey Schutz, who is, believe it or not, a retired school superintendent. So that tells you why we're concerned about our educational system. I had a used car dealer. My old friend Tommy, a Lake County politician. A couple of lawyers. But as I say, I do occasionally now in the twilight of the career, I do occasionally think and wonder about one of my favorite movies, It's a Wonderful Life. And I ask myself, have I positively touched enough human lives in my career and in my lifetime? You tonight have fortified the confidence that maybe I did. Thank you. God bless you all. I love you all. I'll be seeing you.
And especially for your dad, Lisa. Please join us in this tune, because I don't know if I really remember it. So. And if there's someone that wants to come up and sing it with me, please do, so I don't... You want to sing it? Come on. Come on, everybody.
Thank you.